Hi, everybody. It's Gene Simmons, and you're not, and you're listening to the Potter Than Hell podcast with Steve, BC, BB, and Dylan. But you knew that, didn't you?
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Potter Than Hell podcast. This is your last stop on the crazy train of hard rock and heavy metal. So sit back, buckle in, and hang on. Here we go.
Hello, Potter Than Hellions, and welcome back to the Potter Than Hell podcast. This is BB, your host, and tonight I am joined by
Steve
and
BC,
and on the keys,
Dylan.
Guys, what's going on? People out there saying, why the fuck is BB fucking hosting this bullshit fucking episode? But we're going to celebrate a little birthday, BC. BC's already been celebrating tonight. He celebrated way before we started celebrating, so he's got a head start on us. So,
and I dressed up for you.
And you have a collar on. So.
He's the best dressed person here. We got the pregame a little bit, but not as much as BC. A little bit.
Man, oh man. BC's, I think, he's already got 50 years in for my 50 beers for my 50 years in.
Oh, this is the big 5-0,
isn't it? The big
5-0. Ooh,
look out.
Shit.
Look out.
He's on top of the mountain. Now it's all downhill.
AARP, here I come.
We're doing it different. He's going to count down his top 50 albums.
Yes. Number 50.
Number 50, coming in.
Can't believe I made it. Who would have thunk? But, guys, what's going on? BC, what do you got going on at the old ranch down there on Gordon Ave?
I guess living with the Winter Wonderland lady. So I've been decorating lights and stuff and trees and kinds of shit. And other than that, I'm trying to get ready for Christmas, but it's not going on too good.
Nice. What do you got, Dill?
Oh, not too much. Just working. A friend's visiting from Philly this weekend, so we're gonna show her the Scranton sights.
Take her the old office, all the old famous office sights.
Yeah, maybe. She's not as big a fan of The Office, but we'll take her to some.
I like her already.
Terrible. Some of the bars and stuff.
We gotta take Rick Rude to the freaking Scranton.
I told him
office.
I tell everybody when they say, "Oh, Scranton," all the officers said, "Listen, yes, you got to go with either Dylan or BB." Like I hate that fucking show. It's terrible.
I tried not to.
Righty, what's up, buddy? What do you got going on?
Nothing. Not a whole lot. Just getting ready for the holidays and stuff. And I wanted to talk real quick about BB and I were talking earlier before, and I don't know Dylan if you saw it. I know BC definitely did. We were talking about the Wasp and Armor and Saints show that we went to, and I just want to thank the Look It's Rock and Roll podcast. They gave us a good shout-out. Bill Elam did gave the podcast and myself a shout-out. That's a cool podcast. They do a whole Wasp series, which is cool. They did a wrap-up about the tour that actually just wrapped up a couple nights ago, I think, a week ago from when you guys were listening to this. But a video came up on YouTube. And I think I actually have I may butcher it, but I think I have the correct pronunciation of the drummer's name. It's Achilles Priester. And that's the drummer in Wasp. He put up, there's a on Wasp Nation on YouTube, the YouTube channel for Wasp. They put up a video of him doing a drum video to Murders in the New Morgue, Chainsaw Charlie. And I put it on for BB tonight. Fucking insane. You watch that, and he doesn't embellish anything. He plays how the song goes, and it's a bunch of different camera angles on him playing the drums. And I told BB, I said, remember a couple years ago, and actually I still watch this video, I was of the Tool video of Danny Carey playing the drums live, and this one is going to be catching up to it because it's just insane. BC, you saw. What did you think?
Oh, I mean, I loved it. I think when I said the best part of Wasp Pro is going to be the drummer. I mean, because when they... who was drumming before this guy? They had another... And then this guy came in, it was like...
Stet Howland.
But there's somebody after him. Didn't last too long, then they got this guy.
Oh, see, I don't know who that was.
Night and day. Like, phenomenal.
What'd you think, BB?
Yeah, that was a killer drum movie clip. But, man... And he has red cymbals, BC.
Yeah.
Fucking cool.
The one video, it might be that one too. The drum heads are red.
Some of them are red. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
That's the blood.
Could be, yeah.
And he hits hard too. It's like, holy fuck. Have you seen it, Dylan, or no?
No.
You're not a Wasp guy.
I'm not a Wasp guy. I do like Murders in the New Morgue. That's a good song.
Check out that video, though. It's killer. So I just wanted to throw that out there before we got going. And before we do roll on, sorry, BB, for kidnapping the show right off the bat. I want to congratulate Tom and Zeus for having their 200th episode on Shout It Out Loudcast. Congratulations, guys. And thanks for having myself and Sonny Pooney on there. We did a live stream, which would be, when you guys listen to this, like 2 weeks ago. It's on YouTube, and it's on their podcast. We had a great time. It was almost like, it might have been like 3 hours maybe, that we were online shooting the shit. And we had a really good time. And thanks for inviting me, guys. And congratulations for 200 episodes. And cheers to 200 more. So it's like a birthday for them, too.
Yeah,
people.
Really.
So,
birthdays all over.
Yes, I just wanted to...
they're a lot older than me at 200.
Yeah, I just wanted to throw them out there. And, you know, we love those guys. And actually, you will be hearing Tom and Zeus coming up next year also on our podcast, too. Like, we've had them on. We'll have them on again. I have a couple episodes lined up for those guys coming up. So you'll be hearing from them in 2023 as well here.
Nice. Yeah, so last week we released the last... Of the first from last, which was actually the second part, which was the last. Kind of, Dylan came up with this great idea. We picked three different bands. We kind of showcased their first album, what they released when they released their debut album, to the latest album that was released. So BC, you did Pretty Maids. So what'd you think from the first, the last about those guys?
I love Pretty Maids, even though there's a lot of secretist what happened during that episode, which it happens. I recover pretty good because I'm familiar with everybody I wanted to talk about. But, I mean, Pretty Maids to me is just such an underrated band that never really made it big in the States. And unfortunately, I don't know what the band is doing now. It seems to be up in limbo. I don't know what's going on.
Yeah.
There's no official word.
The two main guys are doing separate stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, they're just... doing little separate stuff.
A little solo
stuff.
Come
back together. Who knows? Yeah. Hopefully. Time will tell.
Hey, Dylan, you did Slayer.
Yeah, yeah. One of the few times we've talked about Slayer on the podcast. Repentless was a great album, I thought. It was cool kind of hearing their really cruddily produced first album and then the more well-polished last album, because I don't think they're going to be doing anything anymore.
They're done.
Probably not, but... yeah, it was cool looking at how these three different, very different bands evolved or failed to evolve over the years. Very, very cool.
Yeah, I picked Journey just because Steve Perry wasn't even in the first or the last album, so I thought that was kind of cool because everybody thinks of Steve Perry when you talk about Journey.
It's like Blaze Bailey with Iron Maiden.
With Iron Maiden.
Or Ripper Owens for Priest.
Yeah, but definitely, you know, they definitely evolved, you know, I think for the better, because the first album of Journey, there's some good stuff on there, but there's way too many instrumentals for me, and we've already talked about that. But, Righty, you checked out the first episode. How about the second one?
I did. I checked out the first one. The second one, as we're recording this, hasn't come out yet, so it comes out in 2 days.
Oh, okay.
So that'll be, today's Wednesday, so it'll be out on Friday, and recording today is the 14th of
December.
Yeah, I can't even think of the month. So it'll be out on the 16th. So I haven't checked it out, but I'm looking forward to it. So Repentless was the last one for Slayer. Undress Your Madness was the last one for Pretty Maids.
Yeah.
And then which one was
this? It was released
this
year.
It just came out this year,
yeah.
Right? Something Freedom? Was it Something
it was
Freedom
Escape
or something?
Two.
Escape
That's what it sounded like.
They fucking wish.
Right? The album was... called...
I think it was Freedom.
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 Yeah.
Freedom. Yeah. When we revisit this, I'm gonna do Steve Perry first and last Journey.
Oh, there you go.
So I think it would be either Departure or Evolution maybe for Steve Perry, maybe. And then it would be Trial by Fire. By Fire. But I'm looking forward to checking it out though. So
yeah.
I'll report back.
All right.
Next week.
Gotcha.
When after I hear it. But I'm looking forward to it.
All right. A little bit of news I thought was really, really cool. Being the 14th, Pantera out on tour. A lot of one-song videos out on YouTube. There are a couple of the opening show. The full show is on YouTube, which is great. And they're still playing. The 12th, they played Chile. And tomorrow, the 15th, they're playing in Brazil. Rex Brown actually got COVID. They had a guy from cattle decapitation, BC.
So it's even less Pantera. Then.
It's very now you only got one left.
Then there was one.
Yep, Phil's the only one left.
The cheese stands alone.
But yeah, they sound great. They put on a really good show.
Who's drumming for them? Charlie Benente.
Yep.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yep.
Awesome.
And choice. I was telling Steve, and I don't know if it's like a sticker, but there's during one of the solos, they pan over and you see Zach playing, and there's a silhouette of Dimebag. He looks just like Dime in like the spotlight, which is like spooky and cool all at the same time. Obviously, if I can find a picture to show you guys, really really cool stuff. But yeah, they do a 14 song set list. They open up a new level.
Good opener.
Mouth of War, Length Beyond Strength, Becoming, I'm Broken, Use My Third Arm, 5 Minutes Alone, This Love, Yesterday Don't Mean Shit, Fucking Hostile. Then they do like a little a thing with they play Cemetery Gates, and they show different pictures of the Abbott Brothers, which is really really touching. Then they go into Planet Caravan from Black Sabbath. Then they do Walk. Then they do Domination. And then they close with Cowboys from Hell. So,
not bad.
I'm still keeping my fingers crossed. I see them sometime, somewhere next year. But, yeah, I think it's a pretty good set list. I think it covered a lot of ground. And, you know, and they sound good for, you know, the... probably not really getting to practice a lot together.
I watched some of it. I watched some of the first show, the one you're talking about. It was odd seeing Zach once again play with pants on the stage, because he usually has the kilt on. So I was like, holy shit, he's got pants on. I'm not saying that's a bad thing either.
Well, and like Dimebag used to wear board shorts, so like you figure that he would just wouldn't wear the pants. But,
yeah. So, but yeah. It was cool. And I thought the drums sounded fantastic. Phil sounded really good, but it wasn't Zach trying to be Dime. It was just Zach sounding like Zach playing Pantera. I thought. You still had sense. a lot of the pinch harmonics and shit, but it was cool. It was cool to see those songs perform live again. Although I was, I'm talking like I was at the show. I wasn't at the show, but I would have loved to see them do Revolution Is My Name.
Yeah.
Fucking love that fucking song. But it is cool to see that they're doing that. And, you know, it's not Pantera, but it's... I would go see it because I've never got to see them. And I want to see those songs performed live.
Yeah.
And these guys do the songs justice. And, you know...
They should call themselves the Cowboys from Hell. That would have been a
cool would be real cool. Yeah, like Sabbath, they did Heaven and Hell, Hell.
Right.
And I'm sorry, Planet Caravan blows. I don't care who does it. I fucking hate that song. Come on, guys. They did a great version of Cat Scratch Fever. They should have fucking did that. But it is cool to see these songs being performed live again, in the spirit that it's
that it
intended.
Should be put in. Yeah, mm-hmm. Definitely.
Did Zach overplay at all?
Huh. No,
it didn't seem like it. No. It seemed like he stuck to the script.
Yeah, he was held back. He was held back.
Yeah. It was raining.
Phil was watching him.
Yeah.
Walk on home, boy.
Yeah. Walk on home, boy.
Don't make me get fucking hostile on your ass.
No way, punk.
So, BC, while you're wrapping presents and having sweater parties down there, what have you been listening to?
Like we just talked about Pantera. I was checking out about 8 songs that first show from Mexico. I mean, hey, it's. I thought it was damn good.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of people are bent out of shape. Get over it. The people in the crowd seem to have a good time, so hopefully people adjust and get over it.
Right.
Other than that, it's just a mix of everything. Nothing. I mean, the new Ugly Kid Joe.
Right.
It's good.
About 50-50.
Yeah. It's good for what it is. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
There's like 3 songs that are like, yeah, and everyone's are like, okay, it's good for what it is.
It's still New Ugly Kid Joe.
Still New Ugly Kid Joe, so how can you go wrong?
Righty, what do you got?
All right, BC. Newsflash. I actually listened to the Megadeth album all the way through. I actually did. I where the hell was I going? I was going down. I had to do some Christmas shopping down the line last week, so I had about a 40-minute drive.
I get Johnny's Turbo Man.
So I'm like, yeah, I did. Turbo Man. I want the Turbo Guy. I just want the doll. So I'm like, you know what? Fuck it. I'm going to play the new Megadeth album. I played it. I got like 3/4 of the way through. Then I got to where I was going. Then I listened to the rest of it on the way back. I like it. I think the second half is better. The first half is good. But then like I was having more, I don't know, earworms or more stuff that was catching my thoughts and vibe when on the latter part of the album. But I like it. It's a little long. It's good. I enjoyed it. That I've been binging on Wasp lately. I picked up and you're gonna hear about this later too. So I picked up the Dominator album. I was able to pick that up on vinyl. And you know, anyone that says shipping is bad is bullshit. I fucking ordered that album on Friday and it was on my porch on fucking Monday.
Weren't you the one that said shipping?
He either gets it in 2 days, 2 years, or his fucking's cut in two pieces.
You're calling yourself bullshit, man.
I know. I guess it depends, I guess.
2 days, 2 years, or two pieces, however you want it.
I get thrown a bone every now and then.
That's your new album.
Where did it come from? Pieces.
I don't even know. I don't care. It came in fucking 3 days. And that was over the weekend, too.
Yeah.
So, it might have been from Scranton. I don't know. Fucking 16. Actually, it might have taken longer if it was from there because I probably wouldn't have been Jersey.
Yeah, they didn't
so, right? So I was listening to that. I picked up the reissue of Iron Maiden Number of the Beast where they have the Beast Over Hammersmith in with it also. Really good to hear Bruce singing some of those, Paul Di'Anno songs that you don't get to hear now, like Killers in Another Life, Prowler, Drifter, Murders in the Rue Morgue. It's good to hear Bruce sing those songs. And also, they on the remaster of the Number of the Beast itself, they booted off Gangland and put Total Eclipse in there, which is fucking awesome. So that's pretty much, but I've been listening to a ton of stuff. I've been listening to a shitload of albums that came out this year. I'm trying to narrow my list. I haven't narrowed down to 20, I think. So, but that's I've been binging a lot of 2022 albums this year. And another year, once again, guys, if you're not listening to new stuff, you're missing out on some good shit, baby.
That's for sure. Dylan, what have you been listening to?
Yeah, I was in a similar boat trying to solidify my 2022 list. Rechecking out Crobot, Ghost, Coheed and Cambria. Dad's favorite album of the year. Yeah.
That's on my list.
Dream Widow, of course. It's kind of just been really making sure that I'm satisfied with the albums I'm putting on and not trying to put filler on.
Right, right. Yeah, last week I had the bug, but I didn't really listen to a lot.
Full bug.
I had the full bug, that's for sure. But the Winery Dogs released a song off their new album, Xanadu.
Not the Rush song.
They're not dining on Honeydew.
Nope. You know, pretty much what the Winery Dogs release. You know, nothing fancy. It sounds like the Winery Dogs. You know, you got, you know, Richie's, you know, high vocals. You got the bass, Billy's bass, and, you know, Portnoy's killer on drums. You know, like I said, nothing fancy. It was just good, pretty much, Winery Dog stuff.
Steak and Potatoes Winery Dogs.
Yeah, exactly. And another song, I don't know if you guys saw this or not, Quiet Riot released a song that was kind of hidden in the archives or in Alex Grossi's shuffle, iPod shuffle. It's kind of on the softer side. It's I Can't Hold On. So they put pictures of Frankie Benelli and
Kevin Dubrow.
And Kevin Dubrow in the video. So it has like somewhat of a little meaning to it.
I saw it, but I didn't listen to it. I didn't get a chance to check it out.
I listened to it like...
Who's the singer? It's like a demo, though, right? Is it a demo?
No. I guess.
Yeah,
it sounded really good. It's like, you know how you hear a demo and it's like something like we recorded like in a garage?
Right.
This sounded like it was actually mixed and produced.
Okay.
Who sings on it?
Kevin Dubrow.
Kevin Dubrow sings on it, yeah.
So it's like...
It's an old...
From the vault.
Yeah. But yeah, it's definitely
I'll have to check it. I haven't got a chance. I saw it, but I didn't get a chance to listen to it.
It's not. There's no Paul Sortino, BC. You know.
Who the fuck is?
It's no James Sherman.
No. Yeah. So that's what I got going on. A couple new songs from the Winery Dogs and Quiet Riot. Dylan's got a little Crobot and Ghost and Dream Widow going on. Righty's got the new Megadeth, the little Dominator from Wasp, the new reissued Number of the Beast, and BC's got Pantera and the new Ugly Kid Joe. Dun, 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 dun. How are we doing, Righty? We got it. Did we miss anything yet?
Good-looking adult Mike or whatever.
Yeah, beautiful, beautiful adult Mike.
How do we do, Ryan? We got anything else? Did we cross?
Did we check everything else? I think we checked all the boxes, I think.
All right. You want to just quickly run over the M3 schedule?
Oh, I forgot about M3.
Ooh, yeah.
I'm glad you brought that up. Yeah, they came out with the new M3 schedule. That is going to be...
Back to two days,
but it's Saturday and Sunday now.
And apparently there's an off-site VIP Friday show.
Yeah. Oh, really? I didn't see that. Yeah.
There was the M3 group was up in arms about that. I saw.
And it's May 6th and 7th, so it'll be Saturday and Sunday. May 6th is on a Saturday. So BC and I will be getting off the Monsters of Rock boat on May 4th, and then M3 is May 6th. And we talked about it. We knew that that's when... No. That was going to be.
We knew it was going to be
so
close. And of course, you celebrate May the 4th, so you're going to be
May the 4th be with you, right?
Yep. Do you want me to read those? Can you read those logos?
No, but I'm just hang on. I'm looking at the bottom.
Yeah.
Okay. No. All right. So the bands for Saturday for the first day are I was looking at that and I thought that said ZO2.
No, that's M3 2023.
Okay, all right. Because I'm thinking, oh, ZO2, that makes it a little better. So it's Count 77, which we saw them last year. They played. They were really good. Yeah. Child's Play, BC would like them. Britney Fox, but the Britney Fox is not Britney Fox, not Britney Fox. It's the Billy Childs, the bass player's version. So it's
there's
like the...
Multiple versions of Britney Fox now?
Yeah.
This is the 2X Fox. Oh,
so then,
but I think that's the only version, because there is no other version. Because...
I don't know. But the band's putting out statements that it's not us. So apparently there is still a band.
Well, who's in the band now?
I don't know.
Granted, Johnny D's a drummer, Billy Childs bass.
They were the only two that were there.
The Woodycock guy. Right? Yeah, there were only two original guys that were left.
Yeah, I don't know.
It was Tommy Parris.
Tommy Parris, but Tommy Parris hasn't been with them forever. Hmm. Michael Kelly Smith, he hasn't been with them for way more than ever. Then we got Lita Ford, Quiet Riot as well, with Rudy Sarzo, Slaughter, Winger, Extreme, and an unusual headliner for Saturday night, which
took a page out of the Bullet Journal, which would bring me
there.
Yeah,
Styx, fucking love Styx. I would they would be the one that would get me there for that night. So then the second night are what the hell is that? Oh, Mike Tramp from White Lion, Stephen Riley's L.A. Guns, which they were excellent.
They're
good. We saw them.
They surprised.
Vixen, always good. I would like to see Vixen, because last time I saw Vixen, they played in a room about as big as this fucking room that we're in here on the Kiss Cruise. Firehouse, a little burnout on them. Really good live, though. Steven Adler, I don't want to hear him talk up there. I just miss my friend Slash. I don't want to hear him speak. Loudness, they're going to be on the cruise. So, Great White, I think they're on the cruise, too.
On the cruise,
Warrant, I'm kind of warranted out, and Kix. Sorry, Joe Casero, I'm a little kicked out too.
Interesting. Being the new
Warrant's a new Kix. I think they've been there as much as
they've been at Firehouse.
It's interesting that Kix is not headlining the Kix off show. They're headlining
the last night. The last night,
But Friday was always the Kix off.
It's just interesting that they're.
Yeah,
Warren's turned into a hit.
Close
and also,
kick off.
Somebody pointed out that Loudness has another date,
Poughkeepsie or something.
Yeah, on the 7th. So,
Loudness. Well, they probably only have a fucking visa for so many days in the United States. They're probably getting as many shows in as they can.
Loudness might not play, or they might play early in the day and
maybe play 1 o'clock and go to Poughkeepsie.
Yeah.
And,
I mean that's a drive, but you know.
No, it's probably only about 7 hours. That's nothing for these guys.
To break down and then set up again?
All that shit's there for them. All you gotta bring your guitars and their freaking drums.
That's yeah, it. But like, I don't know.
Dylan
that's
says,
not
no,
necessarily
I,
true.
I accepted that for the last for the two M3s ago. They played Penn's Peak on Thursday. Then on Friday they played, or no, Friday night they played. And they played Penn's Peak, and then Saturday they played M3.
But that's Friday, Saturday. This is the same day, I'm saying.
Oh, it's the same day?
Yes.
Oh,
yes.
Right.
The 7th.
Ready.
See, well, once again, I wasn't listening to Dylan. I thought it was the next day. I apologize.
Day.
Okay. So that
so they
that
might
could,
not be
that
might
could,
not be
that
playing.
Could be tough logistically, so they'll probably play a little earlier than they're on the schedule here.
Yeah.
But,
they'll
I
do
mean,
the noon spot.
I'm out for it. I'm going to be, like I told BC, and I've said it before, by the last day of the cruise, you're ready to get off that fucking boat. And like I said, I love you guys. I love everybody to go with, but I'm sick of everybody by then. I'm sick of, you know what I mean?
I'm sick of drinking.
You,
I'm sick of eating.
You're
sick I'm
sick
of music.
Drinking.
Drinking. Fucking. Pissing. Starting
from
all over
done.
Again.
So, but I'm definitely out for M3. And here we're going to be recording in May and saying, boy, fucking M3 was great. I'm glad we went. I mean, as of right now.
I mean, the only band that I haven't seen that I would be interested in seeing is Styx, which they're the most likely to have a tour around here.
Yeah, you know what
so it's like.
Yeah. I've seen everybody else.
Yeah. I mean, I don't want to see Mitch Malloy with Great White.
No, he's gone.
No, he's gone.
Oh,
no,
he's
there
gone.
Is some new kid.
Yeah, he's gone. There's a new guy.
There's a
kid.
Damn, yeah, I can't make that joke.
And I mentioned last episode.
This guy's good.
I think last episode I said that Terry was back, but he's apparently not. This other guy's still with them. Hmm.
He's like,
yeah, I've seen everybody. I've seen everybody.
Yeah.
Well, except for Mike Tramp. Mike Tramp I have not seen. Child's Play I have not seen either. But like,
but the one guy's,
they're going to play like a fucking half an hour.
But the one guy's dead.
That was a good album that you did.
That was good.
That was a good birthday pick.
I'm glad you remember that, BB. I totally forgot about M3.
Yeah.
Because I didn't write it down.
Speaking of birthday albums.
All right. Let's break into some birthday albums. And this was just pulled out of the fucking air. Nothing really pulled my fancy. This first album we want to talk about, I saw a lot of it on a lot of the melodic Facebook pages. So I was very curious, and I think I listened to maybe like the first song, and I'm like, yeah, we'll throw it on there. We'll go fishing. We'll see what this album is like. But the band is called Coney Hatch. This is their first debut album. It was released May 21st of 1982 off the Anthem Records label. And it was produced by Kim Mitchell. And I think these guys are from Canada. So I think this yes. Kim Mitchell has something a little bit to do with Rush's production of albums back in the day.
Lead singer of Max Webster.
He's the lead singer of Max Webster. And he was the manager of the Runaways. And he's a co-writer on, I believe.
No, that was Kim Fowley.
Oh, okay.
Co-wrote King of the Nighttime World. Come on, Dad.
Yeah. I know. That's what I was thinking. All right.
Oh, okay. I don't know why I thought I saw somewhere he had something. He did something with Rush. Right.
Well, if it's Max Webster, they toured with Rush all the time.
Oh, maybe, yeah. Maybe that's what
and
they, I
saw. And actually, they're the only band, I think, that collaborated with Rush to do a song.
Huh. That's crazy. Well, speaking about doing a little collaboration, there's actually two of the songs on this album is other bands covered. Aldo Nova, they do a cover of a song. And also the American hard rock band Buster Brown.
So connection to Rush. He is who they wrote I Think I'm Going Bald About.
Oh.
Yeah. So there you go.
I know that saying.
There's no thinking about it.
No, that's for sure. But these guys out of Canada, lead vocalist and rhythm guitar player Carl Dixon. Andy Curran is the bass player and also does lead vocals, which we'll get into a little bit. Steve Shelsky is on the lead guitar and backing vocals, and Dave Thumper Ketchum is on the drums. So this album opens up with The Devil's Deck. I think it's like a combination of almost like, they sound like a Foreigner with a little bit of like early Sammy Hagar, Hampton sound to them. But I think it's a great opening track. The vocals are pretty good. For 1982, I think the guitar solo is really, really good. And this guitar player, Steven Shelsky, is definitely underrated for sure. I just think it sounded off really good. It's a great start to a debut album. Song number two, You Ain't Got Me. Kind of short rocking song. It has some more crazy guitar work, which is really, really good. Almost like, it sounds like an autographs song from back in the day. But there's some cool guitar distortion in the song, you know, which really, really sells the song. I think is cool. Song number three is called Stand Up. And this is where these guys go back and forth with the vocals. So Andy Curran sings this song. I don't think it's a great song for the three spot. It's kind of like a momentum killer in a way. The bass and drums are out front and really, really good. They're really heavy. There's some cool keyboard parts throughout the song. The song kind of flatlines it for me, and I just think it's the vocals. Song number four, No Sleep Tonight. We're back up to the rocky music again. Song picks up a little bit momentum. Another song where the vocals are great. I'm really digging this Carl Dixon's vocals now. With the guitar work, they're a great 1-2 combination. There's a really cool shredding solo in this one. And there's like a little bluesy kind of outro solo, which was a really, really good song on No Sleep Tonight. I really enjoyed that one. Song number five, Love Poison. Another Andy Curran song that he sings. Not the greatest, and like I said before, I think it's just because of the vocals. The music is great. It's just kind of flatlining. It's another song that kind of flatlines for me. Nothing really sticks out. Song number six, We Got the Night. More of the stuff that I like from this album. You know, Carl Dixon picks the vocals back up. It's faster, upbeat rocker. The vocals are great. Some really cool background harmonies in this song. Fast chugging riff throughout it as well. Another killer solo, which is really, really good. Song number seven, Hey Operator. It has this rocking piano keyboard start. Definitely like a little toe tapper rocker song. The keyboard player, Steve Shelsky, really, really tears it up on the keyboard. He does a really good job. And there's more, once again, more amazing guitar work. This guy is really, really good. And very underrated for sure on this album. Song number eight, I'll Do the Talking. Once again, Andy Curran does the vocals on this. This one, I almost feel Ace Frehley, like Rock Soldiers or something. But just another song. It's a little bit better than all the other ones because I don't know why. I don't know if it was because of the Ace Frehley thing that I heard in there. But I'm like, oh, this was not as bad that Andy sings. But still, I'm still more of a favorite when this Carl Dixon guy sings. Like song number nine, Victim of Rock, he takes over. I think this is best vocal performance on the album for sure. The sound, the song is more energetic. Definitely another rock and toe tapper. The band just sounds great on this song. They really, really sound good. Song number 10, Monkey Bars. And I actually, this is the song I heard from somewhere. And I
Harpo
don't know.
Harpo played it.
Is that who played it?
Yes, Harpo played it. That's where you know it from. They used to play at the end of the night.
Now, was the band didn't play it. It played over the PA system?
No, they played it.
Did they?
Yeah.
Fuck. And when I heard it, I'm like, how the fuck do I know this song? I'm like, for some reason, I know this is the song, the first and only song I heard off the album.
I was drinking beer.
Yeah.
You heard the Buster Brown version.
I did. But once again, Andy takes the vocals on this one, so it's just kind of meh for me. But not Harpo doesn't. I want to hear Harpo's version. And to close out the album, song number 11, Dreamland. Another rock and toe tapper for sure. The vocals are once again, something that I like from this album. The background vocals are great. Drums are fantastic. More killer guitar work. And it's funny, the original album ends at song number 10. Song number 11 was a bonus from, they remastered the CD in 2005. So Apple decided to throw this one. And there's also another reissue album that has two more songs on it. But Dylan, what'd you think about this Coney Hatch album from 1982?
It's interesting. We always talk quite a bit about how like early 90s, we see a lot of bands that were like, oh, these bands would have been fantastic if they came out during the 80s because it sounds like such a really good 80s hard rock album. But it was released too late, and it was released in the 90s when grunge started coming in. And I almost think this is the case with this album, where it sounds like a really good 70s kind of rockin' album, but it was released in the 80s when things started to get a little heavier. So it almost is kind of a shift in decade situation to what we normally have, which right. I really do like. And it's really funny. I have very similar thoughts about Andy's singing that you had, where I didn't like Stand Up. I was like, oh, God, I hope this guy doesn't sing more on the album.
Right.
But then when he came in and all did the talking, I'm like, he sounds exactly like Ace Frehley.
Okay,
and I'm
good.
Like, I'm so glad you mentioned that, because he does. He sounds like Ace, and I'm on board. I'm liking him more towards the end of the album.
Yeah.
But, yeah, the guitar works really good on this album. I think the songs are really good. Monkey Bars was weird, and I liked it because it was weird. You know, it got the lyrics were cuckoo bananas, if you will. But I thought that this was a really solid album that I think probably would have gotten a lot more traction had it been released mid-70s rather than early 80s. But I thought this was a very solid pick that I never would have listened to outside of that.
Right. Righty. Give it to me straight, buddy.
No. Coney Hatch, I actually got to see these guys live.
Okay.
I got to see them play three songs. They opened up for Maiden in Fastway in 1983 at the Allentown Fairgrounds. I got to see them. And we got there a little late, so I got to see them. I know they did Monkey Bars. I don't know what else they did.
I'm going to tell you a funny story. I went on setlistfm.com to see what they actually... And people only had like two songs, three songs. I'm like, why don't you just put the rest of the songs? Why only put two songs? Of course they did this song, because it's like the opening song to the album. But I didn't realize they only let them do three songs anyway.
No. They're the only ones that I saw.
Oh, okay.
So they were the first band on the bill.
Gotcha.
So,
I'm sorry.
So I only caught the last three songs of their set. Okay. So I don't know what the hell they played before.
Gotcha. Okay.
I like this album. I've since I got to see, you know, in quotations, see them play three songs, I always had a kind of little soft spot for them because, like, literally they're the first band I saw live. Like, Maiden was the first concert, so literally they're like the first band I saw live.
How about that?
Right? So if you're getting technical with that shit, that's what these guys are.
There you go. There's a future trivia question on Jeopardy.
And I got a question for you guys after I go through the album here. Devil's Deck, good, solid, you know, little head bobber to start, smooth vocally. I get a Lover Boy vibe from a lot of the songs on here. I really do.
I can hear it.
I love the guitar playing. Not a balls out rocker that I like to see start an album. Great leads on it. You Ain't Got Me. Another Lover Boy feel for it. Because this one's got more of a pop thing. And I think with the Lover Boy feel that these guys have, I think if they got a bigger push, some of these songs could have been playing on the fucking radio.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah.
I think they really could have. Stand Up is... when they get that down, those chords are fucking Malcolm Young. When they play them chords, when it comes in, they are AC/DC to the friggin' hilt. Not the whole vibe of the song, but when you get the down... That is like Malcolm Young standing there playing them fucking chords. I don't hate it, but and Dylan, I go with you because parts of it has a 70s feel to it on this song. No Sleep Tonight, another pop type song, a more Lover Boy feel to it. It's a little bit of minor shredding in there. Love Poison, this one's just okay for me. The bass sound is really good on this one. We Got the Night. This song should have opened the album. He's got a quick drum start, like a fast rocking song. I was waiting for like a rocker like this. I think that if this song opened up the album, I think you would have been a lot more interested in this album. I think would have made a little more hopeful that you're going to get more of this. Hey Operator, actually Aldo Nova covered this song because the Carl dude wrote it. And, Hey Operator, Aldo Nova did it on Subject, which didn't come out till 1983. But I love this version. I think it's really good, you know, and I was so used to the Aldo Nova version, and I heard this one, I'm like, wow, I like the original, but I like the spin that Aldo put on it. So I like the both versions. I'll do the talking, chompy riff. It's got a good stomping bass and drums. Not a standout, but good. Victim of Rock, head bobbing groove to it. Get some clapping that feels kind of weird in there, I think, that has a little weird thing there. You get a little back and forth lead solos on this one, which I think is very cool. Could have been longer. Good song. Monkey Bars. And you're right, Dylan, this is a weird song. It was always cool when Harpo did it because it was such a difference. Like, holy fuck, they're playing fucking Coney Hatch. Like, what band have you ever seen that ever covered Coney Hatch? Like, that's just insane. And I didn't realize Dreamland was a bonus track. Not bad. Yeah. I like the solo in it. Fun album for the for like a 1982 album. And there's really no skippers on it because I hadn't listened to it in a while, but it was one I would throw on like every a couple of years or something like that, just going through, oh, Coney Hatch, throw it on. But do you guys think that there's a Canada sound for these type bands? Now, just let me name some bands out there and see if you get the same vibe from these guys. Loverboy, Honeymoon Suite, Kickaxe, not so much Triumph, but do you think that there's a Canada sound for some of these bands? Because I get like a Kickaxe, I get a Loverboy, I get a Honeymoon Suite feel throughout this whole album.
Yeah.
And now that I've listened to this again, I get a Coney Hatch. Do you think that there's a sound? And all these bands were out around that time.
I agree with you with all the bands, with the exception of Kickaxe. They're heavier.
They're a little heavier.
But I still get a little vibe, though.
I think just like with any area, like you do have like the influence of the area. Because you think of like the Bay City thrash scene.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the very similar kind of
genetics
and DNA. So I think it's probably a very similar situation with that. Plus, like, Anthem Records was like a label for it.
But I don't know if these bands are,
they probably saw each other a lot on the tour.
If they were localized, you know what I mean? I don't know if one of them was like Winnipeg, which is like West Coast, or like I think a lot of them were probably like Toronto, Ontario, Ottawa type
in that area.
And I know also that Canada radio stations had a mandate where they had to play a percentage of Canadian artists, which is very cool. I think that's awesome. I think
it's cool too.
So that also might have been a factor. So there. I could definitely see some kind of DNA strands.
I get a similar thread. Like you hear one and you hear parts of others. It just kind of popped into my head because I'm like, ooh, I mean, that's. But like some of these, like the couple of these songs, like if Loverboy recorded, I'm looking at one of the songs for the next album. That ain't fucking Loverboy.
A different kind of Loverboy.
Like Devil's Deck. Like that, or there's one that's really malign, like No Sleep Tonight. Mm. If Loverboy released No Sleep Tonight, that would have been a fucking hit for them.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just throwing that out there.
Yeah.
Okay.
You have something there, Reddy. You have something there. BC, what'd you think about the Coney Hatch?
The Coney Hatch, I've probably been listening to this album and their other albums for over 15 years. Nice. Without even knowing it. It was Steve's brother-in-law, a good friend of mine, Damien. I gave him my 200 CD changer. He might have 12 CDs in this CD changer. and three of the CDs in there are Coney Hatch. Mm-hmm. And then there was some Tom Petty and some other stuff. I can't even remember what it is.
The rest is probably just
I think he has a Ministry CD in there.
He has Ministry. He definitely has a Ministry. And there's his other one. It sounded like somebody else. I said, oh, you listen to what he got? He goes, this ain't that. I'm like, oh, sounds like it. Never mind. But I mean, subconsciously, I've been listening to this album for over 15 years. I mean, very catchy. I mean, back in the day, I really never, because I remember being at the garage or doing something, and I'd be like,
they're good, solid, hard rock.
Yeah, right. And I'm like, ooh, I said, these guys are doing a cover of Aldo Nova. Because at the time, I didn't know these guys did that.
Mm-hmm.
Which I laughed when this came up. I'm like, ooh, Coney Hatch. And you have to really, I listened to them like, I've heard this 100 times.
And I didn't even know it.
I didn't even know it. No, seriously, I would listen to it, and I'd be like, And I just think of myself, God knows who it is, because Dean would listen to Ministry, to Coney Hatch, to Tom Petty, to God. There was this artist, I forget who it was. I'm like, is this so-and-so? He goes, no. I'm like, no, never mind. But solid album. I mean, there's some weaker points in this, but Monkey Bars, and then we go to see Harper on Monkey Bars. I'm like, so
great. I think that's what got Damon to come to see Harper with us. Dude, they play Monkey Bars. And they
can't seriously, that might have very well been it, because he's probably the only person I know that's really a diehard Coney Hatch fan.
Yeah. Nice. All right. Then the next one we're going to talk about, BC. We're going to go back to 2014. Either you love them or you hate them. The BB Birthday Special, we're bringing back Steel Panther with their third studio album, All You Can Eat, released on April Fool's Day of 2014, off the Open E Music label. The good old length is 48 minutes and 9 seconds. It's produced by Steel Panther and also Jay Rustone. And they released three singles off this album. So goes in the first song off the album, Pussy Whipped. Starts with like a cool, slow acoustic, almost like a Mexican kind of melody feel to it. Then it kicks into Steel Panther, heavy rocking. Just pretty much about exactly what the title says. You know, Pussy Whipped, your girlfriend wears the pants. You know, just a funny pun song. It's fun. It's funny. If, like I said, if you like it, you like it. If you don't, you hate it. It's just one of those love hate, and it's funny. There's some funny stuff about this album, and the music on it is fucking balls out amazing. Song number two, Party Like Tomorrow Is the End of the World. Even though this lacks the Steel Panther stamp of like perversion, it's still a catchy tune. This is definitely one of the songs they released because it's not like their.
There's not as much banter. Profanity in it.
Yeah, right. But really, really good song. Satchel's guitar work in this, fucking killer. Some cool shredding. There's some bridge tapping he does when in there. And they even take care of Wrighty. Right at the end of the song, they give you three hays. Hey.
They know what I like.
And I think I heard Mark say, that was for Wright. So, song number three, probably my favorite song on the album, Glory Hole. It's just fucking go, genius, man. This song, this is a single, this is a video. It's just fucking genius how they can just write a fucking funny, catchy song about the fucking hole in the wall. It's great. And I love how certain parts, Michael Starr does that. Like David Lee Roth scream. Wow. It does it so good. And Glory Hole. This is probably one of their most popular songs. Definitely a staple live that they do still to this day. Song number four, Bukkake Tears. This one's out there. This one
if you don't know what it is, look it up. just type it in your computer.
Don't do it in front of your kids.
What do you mean? This is the power ballad. This is the Bukkake Tears is a power ballad. It's I love the music of this song. And once again, the lyrics are hysterical. It goes from like super soft to like killer shredding. Like the first two verses are kind of slower, and it just takes off from there. Really, really good song. Song number five, Gang Bang at the Old Folks Home. And once again, just nothing but laughs. One of the lines in these golden girls really been around the block. I got a rim job while she was knitting some socks. Like, it's funny. It makes you laugh. If you're having a shitty day and you're into this, it just makes you laugh. And Vivian Campbell does the solo in the song, which I thought was really, really cool. Makes a little appearance at the old folks' home. So who knows what Vivian Campbell was doing there. Song number six, 10 Strikes, You're Out. This has like a cool, like a ZZ Top riff throughout the song. It's Steel Panther's breakup song. You know, 10 strikes, you're out. There's more Michael Starr, David Lee Roth screaming and laughing. You know, winking at my friends, touching his iPhone, giving the dog VD. You know, that's why you're breaking up, BC. You got 10 strikes and you're out.
You got to go.
And strike number 10, BC, because he drank his last beer. So you pack your shit and get out of here. But another fun lyrically written song for sure. Song number 7, The Burden of Being Wonderful. This is another song that they released because it's pretty much, not that much perversion in it. This is kind of like a You're So Vain song from them. A perfect body, a perfect face. It's like God's best work all in one place. There's some violin in it to give it a different spin on something from Steel Panther. It's just another fun song just from the lyrics alone. Song number 8, Fucking My Heart in the Ass. This is a great up-tempo rocker with some cool slowdown parts right before the chorus, which it picks up again into another crazy solo from Satchel. Song number 9, BVS, which is Big Vagina Syndrome. It's described as fucking the Lincoln Tunnel with an Oscar Mayer wiener or two. Once again, just makes you laugh. And the musicianship again on this song is crazy. Song number 10, You're Beautiful When You Don't Talk. they kind of slow this one down a little bit more. Another Steel Panther power ballad, if you will. Once again, musically, the song is great. You're beautiful, you're so beautiful and young. If you only were born without a tongue. It's just sometimes the lyrics, they're just fucking crazy. Song number 11, If I Was the King. Another song, I think musically I'm not into this song as much. The lyrics, again, kind of sell it. And the closer, She's on the Rag. different, this one definitely different sounding for Steel Panther. Almost, it's like a rock pop parts in it. But sometimes, unfortunately, if you've been there, you know what the song is about. If you haven't, check the song out. You know what they're talking about. Righty, how many times did you laugh at this album?
All right. There's songs on this album that are just like fucking kill me. Like Pussy Whipped. We all know that guy. And I can name someone right here and everybody in the room would be shaking their fucking head. Yes, yes. And I love the line, now your dick gets sucked as much as the Pope. I fucking love that line. Starts out with a little flamingo guitar. It's got a little flute in there. It's actually pretty good. Satchel absolutely tears it up on this.
What kind of guitar did you say?
Huh?
What kind of guitar?
Like a flamingo.
Flamenco.
Flamingo, right?
Flamingo. No, flamingo is an animal. Flamenco.
Well, I thought it... Well, you know what I mean.
You know what I'm trying to say.
You know the flamenco, the shape of a flamingo.
Shut the fuck up. Party Like It's the End of the World. Fun song about not giving a fuck. I like... Find some horny cougars and shoot some cougar porn. The little cowbell in here, BB. The video was really cool for this one, like a big friggin' party. Glory Hole. This song and the video is like you kind of want to throw up parts of the video. It's fucking crazy. It starts out with the sound of the zipper. But when it kicks in, like you get the double bass accent there. It's very cool. The chorus is catchy. It's an insane song, but like it's so genius how they do it. I like when it slows down. Feel somebody new at the club. You know, it's fucking insane. Song is ace. The solo is great in this one too. Bukkake Tears. Like I said before, if you don't know what it is, look it up. Pull it up on your wife's phone. If you don't know what it is, ask her to borrow your phone for a minute.
Incognito
tap. Punch that in. You got so much love on your face. I couldn't see the tears. It's just fucking crazy. But it's like the musically, it's like so melodic. It's like crazy. Gang Bang at the Old Folks Home is just another one that is fucking crazy. They're on a roll, like lyrically, like crazy shit like this wise. This song is got to be a script from a fucking porn movie. It's got to be. It's fucking has to be. But musically, another home run. Just music is fantastic. Great leads between the verses. Where's the one thing? I won't say that lyric. Okay, I'll leave that one sit where it is. So check out the lyrics. Seriously, all these songs. 10 Strikes, You're Out. This is probably one of the most fun songs on the album. That's not like, you know, crazy about like, you know, porn or whatever and shit. But it's pretty funny. Each strike is like funnier and crazier than the last one. And the one is like, whatever strike is, I don't know what it was, but you better not do it no more. He's like, I don't even forget what the fuck even number I'm on. You know what I mean? Kind of gets crazy like that. The Burden of Being Wonderful, I could definitely sympathize with that song. He may have written about me, BB.
Ooh, you never know.
I don't know.
Because you didn't meet him on that cruise. Out
in the car, the wife's like, yeah, you're wonderful, right? but it's fun, though. And, like, he even makes fun of himself. You know, like, I would never be, like, confused with Leonardo da Vinci. Like, something like that, like, is the gist of the one lyric is cool. Fucking My Heart in the Ass. This one I don't really care for. It's okay. That one. BVS is pretty funny. It makes me giggle a little bit. The chorus is awesome in it. The solo is killer in this one, too. You're Beautiful When You Don't Talk. I'm meh on that one. Eh. If I Was the King, I fucking love it. When he fucking sings the part, If I Was the King, I'd Lower the Drinking Age So Little Kids Could Get Drunk, Too. I always pictured Killian walking down the street with a beer when this part comes on. I don't know why. He's 21 years old now, okay, everybody? So don't get fucking nervous. He's 21, right?
Dad.
He's 20.
18.
He's 18. Oh, he's 18. Jesus. Okay.
Colin's 20.
Oh, Colin is.
Colin,
okay.
Yeah, Colin will be 21 in March.
In Canada, I guess.
We'll take him to Canada to get him ripped up. But I always thought of Killian when that was when little kids could get drunk, too. I always thought of Killian walking down the street holding a beer. Sorry. But really good song. She's on the Rag. This one's got a weird techno feel to it.
Yeah, right?
You know what I mean? It kind of does. Musically, it's pretty cool. The solo is really, really good. But I think if they flipped the last two songs, I think If I Was a King would have been a great way to end the album. And I think it's like two songs too long. I think if you knocked off She's on the Rag in maybe either Fucking My Heart in the Ass or You're Beautiful When You Don't Talk, I think if you knocked off them two and you ended the album with If I Was King, I think you would have a fucking boom, killer album like that. Just those couple songs are kind of meh for me, but fun album, just one to put on and just laugh. Like, if you take these guys seriously, you have absolutely no fucking sense of humor at all, and you shouldn't be listening to music at all. But it's fun. Musically, these guys are great. And we've discussed it many times. We've said on this podcast before, if these guys did a serious, like, just straight-up hard rock album, it would be kick-ass. Although they do have an album coming out early next year. And they have a single out right now. It's called 1987. And it's very cool.
Yeah.
It name drops a lot of bands and stuff like that. So check that out. And so I'm curious to see if we're going to get more of that. You know what I mean? More of straightforward, you know, because it's like, it's not a fuck around song. It's just like about what they were into. It starts out with talking about Appetite for Destruction. It's like they're like the first lines in the song. So hopefully maybe we can get a straightforward album and see how it goes for these guys. But I won't mind another fuck around album because, you know, I mean, it's still Panther.
Right.
So love or hate them, just enjoy. Have a sense of humor, people.
Dylan. Sorry, sir.
After I took a half an hour on that one.
Dylan, here's my disclaimer. I'm sorry I had to make you listen to this album.
No. Well, here's the thing. This, I think, is their best album. Like, I think it's their best album. This is the album that I get the most songs from. I think musically they are at their peak. Like, Pussy Whipped is such a heavy opener. You're like, oh, shit. Like, fuck, what's going on here? Glory Hole, which is a fan. I love the like the jam at the end that they do, like on the riff. I love the time change too during that last chorus where they kind of do like a little breakdown-ish type of situation. I think that's usually their closing song, which is a perfect
oh, really?
Set closer. Like, just going out on that. Ding, 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 ding. Gang Bang at the Old Folks Home is like the Steel Panther that I wish I could always get, where, like, the joke is on them, and, like, they're in this, like, horrible situation, and, like, it's really, you know, they're taking the piss out of themselves. You know, 10 Strikes You're Out is fantastic. If I Was the King's great. Like, there's some really, really great songs on here. You know, I have my usual problems with Steel Panther on this album, but I do really like the musicianship. Satchel can fucking play play a fly off a shit. Like, that's how he's a phenomenal guitarist. He could, like, he's so good. I mean, he was with Fight for an album.
Yep.
War of Words, I think he was on. Was that the album he was on?
Yeah.
So, I mean, Rob Halford knew how good he was, but yeah, this
Russ Parrish, his name is.
Yeah, Russ Parrish. Very, very, very good album, I think. Minus a couple songs, just like Dad. I don't really dig, you know, She's on the Rag or You're Beautiful When You Don't Talk. I think those are kind of like fillerish. But like when they're rocking on this album, I think it's the best musically of the night.
Right. Nice. All right, BC.
Yeah, right. I can remember these guys playing M3. And they came out. Of course, we knew who they were. And there were so many people, even mainly women. And they were flipping them off. Fuck you guys suck. Da, da, da. And we were just laughing our ass off. You remember this? And ever since then, this band is just musically phenomenal, I think. This is their, I believe, their third album. Mm-hmm. The next two after this, I thought were a little, they're trying way too hard.
We'll see next year.
That's right.
Yeah, that's true. So, from what I heard.
The next album is called Lower the Bar, so
They did.
Definitely do it.
Everyone that came out, me and your dad, I'm like,
tune in next December.
I mean, fucking part of like Tomorrow's End of the World, that's a good one. 10 Strikes, You're Beautiful. I agree with Steve. If I Was King, that's my favorite off this album. That finish it off, and if they knocked off a few songs, because it's only so many times you can talk about. But I like this overall, very good. I mean, one before it, a little bit bitter. Is it here? It doesn't really matter. But I'm looking forward to next year and see if they can redeem themselves.
I think it comes out in February.
I heard the
1987.
Yeah.
It's not bad.
No, it's a little bit more
mainstream.
Yeah. Brian Adams, Summer '69 type.
Yeah. You know, a lot of acoustic parts goes to electric, comes back to acoustic.
I kind of like that. I always said, and we've talked a million times, I would love to see these guys get
put. Maybe Dylan will add that to the Spotify playlist.
It's out there.
For your listening pleasure.
Great pick.
Yeah, thank you. All right, there's my first two albums from Coney Hatch, their debut album, to All You Can Eat from Steel Panther. My gem song, since the holidays are right around the corner, and it seems like ever since COVID, everybody is mashing songs together. I came across this somehow. My cousin sent to me, and then like the next day was all over Facebook. This guy mashed Van Halen's Ain't Talking About Love and Feliz Navidad. So they're calling the song Ain't Talking About Feliz Navidad. Dylan's going to play this right now.
My love is right.
Song put you guys in the holiday spirit. That was Jose Van Hiliano.
Gonna get you through the festivities.
Right? BC, you'll be listening to that while you're wrapping presents. Fucking ain't talking about love, Feliz Navidad.
Aaron.
Next year, you should put that on your freaking ugly sweater. All right.
Every sweater he wears is an ugly sweater.
Oh.
Oh. Although he doesn't wear one. That's the only time I see BC wear a sweater. Is an ugly sweater party.
Yeah.
Pull this thread as he walks away.
All right. Album number 3 we're going to talk about here is, I was surprised when I learned that this was a Frontiers record, because I did not know this was a Frontiers record until I printed out the little Wikipedia thing. But this band is a supergroup from, I guess we're going to call from Frontiers. The band is called Level 10, and the album is called Chapter 1. The two guys that put this together are Russell Allen, who sings vocals for Adrenaline Mob, and...
TSO.
And TSO?
TSO, yeah.
Oh, does he?
Yep. Oh, yeah.
Okay. And then Matt Sinner. He's the bassist that put this together. And there's a Sinner album I think we talked about a couple years ago. I don't know if it was last year.
There's a new Sinner album out for this year.
And this, they have a new one out this year. So this is their little super goop collaboration. And the drummer is Randy Black. And the guitar player is Alex Boyrot from...
Bayrot?
From Primal Fear. And Roland Grappow from Master Plan. And the keyboard player is
Alessandro
Del Vecchio from Hardline. So
he's the one that does all the Frontier stuff.
Yeah. So like I said, this was a surprise. It was a Frontiers, but it was released January 23rd, 2015. So maybe that's why I'm not getting the Frontiers. You know, this is early Frontiers. It's not like the 2022 Frontiers. Everything sounds like
same.
Sounds like Frontiers.
All the Revolution album. Saints albums sound the same.
Yeah, they all sound the same. Everybody sounds the same. But kind of like all the bands from Canada in the early 80s, they all sound like this.
You did a new Revolution Saints?
I did Eagle Fly or something like that.
Sounds like that.
Something like that, yeah. Well, because this is a different band. Joel Hoekstra and...
Jeff Pilson,
yeah.
I like it.
Yeah, so this is the only album these guys released. Which is kind of sucks, because I really dig this album.
We're waiting for Chapter 2.
Yeah, really. Come on now. It's been 7 years. Come on. Almost 8. Let's go here. But opens up with the rocker Cry No More. I think this song may be my favorite song of the night. It crosses all the T's and dots all the I's for me, for sure. The vocals are great. Guitar work is amazing. It has a catchy chorus. Has some really good background vocals. There's a synthesizer underneath the guitars. I'm sucked right in. I love this. I love this album already, but definitely love that song, Cry No More. Song number 2, Soul of the Warrior. This is like a heavier, darker sound than the previous song. And it has some really cool synth parts in it. Some gang band vocals, which are really, really good at the chorus. And once again, more shredding. In another killer outro solo, And you're definitely not gonna you're not getting shorted on shredding on these albums for sure. And this is another guy which tears it up. Song number three, When the Nighttime Comes. This song starts kind of has a little cool chugging riff throughout the whole song. It absolutely love the vocals on this one. They're screaming vocals, they're softer vocals, but once again the MVP is this shredding guitar. Once again, really, really good stuff coming out of this album. Song number four, One Way Street. It has some cool pinch harmonics. This is the first time you're hearing pinch harmonics on the album. And there's a little wah-wah pedal in there. The drums are out front and loud and crisp. I really, really like this one. Song number five, Blasphemy. This has like a big theatrical sound to the song. Almost like a TSO, but now we know where the TSO comes from. The vocals are almost like a little angry. And then there's a little spoken word in there. There's a slong, powerful solo in it, which is really, really good. Song number six, Last Man on Earth. Has some cool time changes, some start and stop vocals. Rockin' harmonies at the chorus. Really, really good tune. Song number seven, In for the Kill. Some more crazy time changes. I love the angry vocals on this one. And the guitar solo has some really neat distortion in it. Song number five, Voice of the Wilderness. Another heavy song. Vocals are great. Love the drum fills that they're using. Song number nine, All Hope is Gone. This is like their power ballad of the album. It's a little bit slower than the rest. And I'm glad they put it at nine. They didn't put it up at three or four. It's right down there at nine. It's some really nice piano work. You know, some soft vocals. Definitely a kind of a nice pace changer, if you will, to the album. But then we go back into the rockin' with song number 10, Demonized. Another heavy tune with some really angry vocals. More great guitar work. Chugging riff, loud drums, absolutely love it. Song number 11, The Soul is Eternal. Another straight-up rocker. Nothing fancy with this one, just a really, really good song. And song number 12 closes the album with Forevermore. Very heavy drum combo guitar riff. More melodic harmonies from the band at the chorus. Once again, I think I already said this three times, absolutely love this album. So, BC, what'd you think about level 10 with chapter 1?
You're pulling a Dylan here. Dylan's always the one that brings something that blows me away.
Is this a new Dream Widow for BC?
I don't know about that, but... I put this on it. Woo! I never heard this before, and, I mean, it was never on my radar, and I threw this on. I'm like, oh, wow. I'm like, fucking, woo! Right off the get-go, I mean, and like... It's definitely not a modern Frontiers band.
Oof, no.
Because every fucking band
sounds... Because it sounds different.
It sounds totally... Yeah, this is... Like, they got their own sound, which is... blew me away. I mean, One Way Street, I really like that one. In for the Kill. Angriness. I kind of tend towards... Lean towards that way sometimes.
Shocking.
So Demonized, I like that. I mean, overall, I mean... Even the slow song wasn't that bad. Oh, shit. Very... Musically, I mean... I love it. I mean, that's...
Nice.
So that's definitely and it came out Ta-da. 7 years ago.
Yeah, right.
So where the fuck chapter two, damn.
Hiding, no, BC. Hiding under a rock in the Frontiers vault.
Russell Allen, I mean, he's phenomenal. I mean, from back in Adrenaline Mob back in the day and other artists, he did something
else. He's done a ton of stuff.
I really, really, totally love his voice. But hey, I love
nice.
It.
Nice.
Great pick.
Dylan.
Yeah, this was a good album. I definitely caught the Frontiers records of it at times. Mm. Not that it was bad. I enjoyed the album, for sure. The only real songs that kind of didn't hit as well for me were All Hope Is Gone and Soul of a Warrior. Those two weren't as impactful for me. Because there were times where the background vocals seemed like brighter than the instrumentals. Like, the instrumentals were like really heavy and, you know, like... metal, and right. Then the background vocals were kind of like uplifting and kind of should be more on a hard rock song than a metal song,
right?
So the dissonance there was a little strange for me, but for the most part, the album kicks ass. I really liked Blasphemy. That song was great. Demonized was fantastic. When the Nighttime Comes, I really enjoyed. There is a lot of great stuff on here that, again, this is an album that I never would have picked up on my own, didn't know it existed.
No.
I recognize some of the names. Primal Fear, of course, I knew because I remember the lead singer sounded very much like Rob Halford. If right, Dad?
Mm-hmm.
You know. But it's a good, very, very good metal album with the Frontier sound. Not as heavily as nowadays.
Early Frontier sound.
Yeah. Early Frontier sound, yeah. When everything still had a little more identity. But great pick. Really good. Enjoyed it.
I'm glad you liked that. Alrighty, righty.
Alright, BB, I love you, buddy. But,
oh, no.
But
I expected that for the last album, not this album.
Let me just get in. Russell Allen, he was the main singer in Symphony X. He's got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, he got 11 albums with Symphony X. With Jorn Landy, he does 4 albums with them. Adrenaline Mob, he's on all the singers for there. With this, he's on both Joel Holstra's solo albums that he put out. He's one of the main singers in TSO, the East Coast version that we get to see. And he's him, Joel Holstra, Jeff Plate, Chris Caffrey, and I apologize, I don't know the violin player's name, TSO, but the East Coast one is fucking killer, absolutely killer. Mm. And Russell Allen is a huge part of that, and his voice is great. Very, very powerful singer. Very powerful singer. He's one of those guys that is never in that conversation that should be in that conversation. Ooh. Fucking fantastic. Chapter 10, I'm only busting your balls. Fucking album is fucking awesome. I had this in my iTunes.
Oh, okay.
Because when I was going through and I'll do a playlist and I'm like, oh, shit, I already got this. I'm like, ooh, I remember this album.
Nice.
And I actually... Had listened to this album like last year. I put it on and I played it and I'm like, fuck. Cry No More opens up with that fast, like Whitesnake, like Bad Boys riff right off the bat. I'm like, if you have anything that reminds me of Whitesnake, Bad Boys, and I'm surprised Dylan likes it, I'm in. I fucking, the production right off the bat. And one thing you could say about the Frontier stuff is it may start all to sound samey after a while, but the production is always great. The production is always crisp, and you can hear the bass and the drums and the guitar and the other guitar, and you know, you can hear and keyboards accents and shit, you can hear it all. The production is always good on that stuff. I like the chorus, catchy little keyboard intro to the solo that totally fucking rips. The drums kick up at the solo. Soul of a Warrior. That one's just okay for me. It's got some grindage in it. It's pretty good. The solo's kind of bluesy in there. Shreds at the end. When the Nighttime Comes, back to the more up-tempo stuff. The solo's killer in it. This guy fucking tears it up. One Way Street. This has got a star for me. It's got like a keyboard build at the beginning that I always like. Kind of Deep Purple-ish. Kind of a build to it for me. When the song kicks in, the riff is friggin' fantastic. Then you get the grindage for the riff. Song is killer. Background vocals, you know, the vocals are fantastic. But like on this one, the drum fills are very Rush-like on this one. I don't even know who the drummer is on this album. Who's the drummer on this album, maybe?
Maybe I didn't say who was on here.
You did, but I forget who.
Randy Black.
Okay, Randy Black, you fucking kick ass on this song. Fantastic song, Blasphemy, and I don't know, some maybe Dylan said it, definitely TSO feel to it, and he was in TSO in 2015, so that some of that stuff leaked over into this album, and it's got a weird kind of drum beat to it, but once it gets going, it's really good. The tempo picks up. The solo friggin' kills on this one. Last Man on Earth. Really good. Short solo's a little short for me on this one. In for the Kill, this is a star album, star song for me. Back to the Fast Tempo Rockers. Just this one is friggin' aces for me. I fucking love this one. Voice in the Wilderness. This was one I thought was gonna be like a more mellow type thing. But like it grinds right from the start. I'm like, holy fuck. Intense. This song is probably like the most intense song on the album for me. The vocals and the, like the layered vocals are great. The solo's killer. Then you get like a dual harmonic solo at towards the end, and then you get the sick. There you go, BB.
We got sick some bananas.
Sick drums here on this one.
All right.
Bring us back into the chorus. Great song. All Hope Is Gone. Little slower song. Probably what you would expect from a song that's called All Hope Is Gone. keyboards and piano, but they're good though. I like it. Russell's vocals are just like totally fitting the song. Demonized, back to the crunchy guitars and shit, double bass, rocker song. Some kick-ass back and forth on the guitars. Sick banana solo on this one, BB. There's your sick banana solo. The solo is eternal. This is another one. I thought this was going to be one of those slow songs. This sounds like it's going to be like a slow song. It's going to be about 8 minutes long that Sonny Pooney's going to fucking hate, that I'm going to love. But it's a rockin' song. Great head bobber. I love the pace of it. The vocal cadence is fantastic. The guitars are crunchy in it. The solo's kind of bluesy to start, then picks up for absolutely killer. Another sick banana solo there. Forevermore. A good track for the ending one here. Fast-paced song that keeps it going with no slowdown for the verses. Great finish. This was an album I was like, fuck yeah.
Fuck yeah. That's what we're talking about. All right. And the last album released this year, we're going to go with Blackstone Cherry. Live from Royal Albert Hall, y'all. I love these guys. These guys are, like I keep saying, the modern day Lynyrd Skynyrd, you know, down from Kentucky, just tearing it up. This album was released June 24th of 2000. It was recorded September 29th of 2001. It's off the Mescott label. It's an hour and 29 minutes long. Chris Robertson's on vocals, Ben Wells on lead guitar, Steve Jewell on bass, and John Fred Young on drums. It starts off with Mean Mary Jane. This is one of their staple songs. Great opener for this. This is definitely like the Blackstone Cherry Southern rock sound that you come to the show for. And I can just tell already, Wrighty's rolling his eyes the first song out of the gate. Chris is already trying to get the crowd involved and talking to them and let them sing certain parts. So I'm giggling like a little two-year-old. Song number two, Burning. Great live drum sound. He kills it. This John Fred guy really kills it on drums. Once again, more audience participation. The solo from Ben Wells is great in this. Song number three again. Great rendition of the song, because it's definitely a lot heavier than it is on the album, but I love when they do that. This is off the Human Condition album. Song number four. Yeah, Man. When I heard this song, I'm like, I didn't know this one. So I kind of had to go looking, and it's actually off a special edition from the Folklore and Superstition album. They released back in the day, and it's off the second disc. So I never heard of it. So this is, I love when they pull out a super duper deep track that I never knew existed. So I need to check the second disc out. Song number five, In My Blood. This is one of the singles they released back in the day. Another great Southern hard rock song. Has some more audience participation in the middle of the song. Then they go in this little jam, then they go back into the song. And once again, the lead singer, Chris, keeps talking to the audience. And thinking, oh boy, Wrighty's going to start bashing him. But song number six, Ringing, BC Maybe. That's why I picked it. Get Wrighty a little.
He's got to torture me somehow.
So this is the only way I could think of doing it. But
that's why I highlighted it in pink.
Yes! Oh! Song number six, Ringing in My Head. Another kick-ass song with some cool back-and-forth singing between Chris and Ben. Guitar work. Ben's a killer on this, and the drums are awesome as well. Song number seven, Like I Roll. This is a super catchy song with some good band harmonies. The audience really likes this one. This is one of their fan favorites. Song number eight, Cheaper to Drink Alone. Another great rockin' song that these guys put out. Kind of a little bit heavier than the album, which really, really gets my interest. And in the middle of the song, then they do the band intro, and you know, they kind of waste a lot of time in the song. And they even introduce the guy on the banjos. But then they go back into the song, which I understand, you know, the guy's probably out going off stage, having a beer, come back, you know, have a little Pabst Blue Ribbon. But, you know, I understand they got to do it.
The 99 pack of it.
Yeah, right.
Heineken, screw that shit. Pabst Blue Ribbon.
Song number 9, Hell or High Water. This is a great Blackstone Cherry song. Absolutely love this one. Chris's vocals are spot on in this song. Has that cool southern rock sound to it. Absolutely love it. Song number 10, Soul Creek. My favorite Blackstone Cherry song. I'm so glad they put it on here. It's pretty much about drinking and partying in the woods. And who doesn't like a song about that? Except for Chapman. Song number 11, Devil's Queen. Another fast-paced rocker with some more back and forth drum and guitar work. Super fast-paced jam they do at the end of the song, which is really, really good. Song number 12, which is the drum solo. But you kind of can skip that one. Song number 13. This is where I want to talk about the album and the DVD, because they released the CD and you get a DVD with this. This was released in 2012. Chris's father passed away, and it's not caught on the CD, but on the DVD. After the drum solo had come out, they put like a little chair and there's the Blackstone Cherry symbol is on like a blanket. And they put it in the chair. There's like a blue light, and
is
he comes up.
The chair, the Blackstone Cherry.
The Blackstone, the Black Cherry Stone.
Cherry.
And Chris goes on to talk about, you know, this song meant so much more to him. His dad passed away. Blah blah blah. He has a real hard time getting through some of the parts on this, but the one thing he says that's not on the album, he said right before his dad passed away, I guess there were people over saying you know somewhat of their goodbyes, and just like the song, it says hard work and love of friends, a woman that understands, and he said his dad has all three, so it was really, really cool. And he starts going into the song, and towards the last verse there, everybody takes out their cell phones, so there's like a video from behind him singing, and this whole little theater has like lights from their phone. It looks like stars. It's really, really cool. I believe just that video is probably on YouTube. So just check it out, because it's really, really moving. Song number 14, In Love with the Pain. This we picked the tempo back up, more Blackstone Cherry that you're looking at if you're looking for some rock and stuff. This really picks it back up. Good song. Song number 11, Blind Man, another hard rocking song, another fan favorite. And then you get the almost like the finale here. Blaming on the Boom Boom, which was a single, which was another one of their bigger hits. White Trash Millionaire, which Ben tears it up on the guitar. Song number 18, Lonely Train, another great southern rock song. And they close the show out with song number 19, Peace is Free. Another staple for them. They've been closing out shows with that for a while. Definitely the audience is into this. Certain parts of this album are really, really good. And, you know, pretty much like a live album, there are some tankers, you know, between the drum solo and a lot of bantering back and forth from the audience. So give it to us, Wrighty.
Okay. Blackstone Cherry. I have one regret about these guys, that I did not go to see these guys with you guys the night after we saw Armored Saint down in Allentown. I should have fucking went that night, because I never got to see these guys live. And another thing, it fucking baffles me, just absolutely blows my mind, how these guys are playing like the Royal Albert Hall in stadiums and shit in England, in Europe, and they're playing clubs in the United States. I don't get it. It just fucking blows my mind. And I'm more of a, you know, if you want to call me a hits guy for these guys, like the songs that everybody knows, but I had never listened to this album until... you picked this. I was aware of it. I knew it came out. I had it in my iTunes, but I just never got around to listening to it. I will pluck off, you know, like the songs I know, like Me, Mary Jane, like A Roll and Soul Creek and, you know, White Trash Millionaire. But when I delved into this album, I'm like, number one, the production on it is absolutely fucking fantastic. Me and Mary Jane, it's one that I know. I was glad they started off with a song that I knew. Heavy. Excellent vocals, the song crunchy and heavy, some wah pedal going in there. The drum sound and the drummer on this album is fucking killer. He's the drummer of the night, this guy, whatever the fuck his name is.
He's the guy with two first names.
He's the guy with two first names. But listen to the bass during the solo. I mean, the solo tears it up, but listen to the bass during it. Kicks up at the end, burning. This one I didn't know. Kick-ass groove to it. Killer solo again. The next song, intense song. It's got like a. Here's a new one, BC. It's got a cool, heavy looseness to it. I was trying to think of a way to describe it, but it's got like a heavy looseness to it. And this show has me like fucking rocking my head. Good sign. Solo's great. The bass and the drums underneath. You know, I'm a big fan of checking out the band. What they do during a solo. Yeah, man. Great build into it. I mean, these guys are like, the momentum is just fucking just going on this album. In My Blood, Island Jam. I kind of like this one. I'm one that kind of likes longer songs. And this one's more of a mid-tempo, but it's got like a spacey guitar effect. Picks up for the pre-chorus. Awesome drum fills in there. The drummer's killing it, but like they get like a little reggae thing going here, like kind of like a cool thing that you would hear maybe like the Police doing or something like that. That is kind of odd for these guys, but it's pretty cool though. Ringing in My Head, fucking fantastic. Like I Roll, song's got a cool swing to a driving song. Cheaper to Drink Along Alone, another great song. Hell in High Water, good song. Like got a mainstream feel to it. Which would be Disc 2, Soul Creek, fucking... You said that was your favorite song, yeah. I think, BB. Song is killer. Devil's Queen, fast, heavy rocker, and like, these guys are, they're like... I don't know, do I want to call them like a metal Lynyrd Skynyrd, maybe? I think that would maybe be the best way that I could, you know, describe them for how I'm listening to this album. The drum solo... I understand the need for it or whatever, but it's not a, you know, Things My Father Said. That's a song that I choose not to really delve into, you know, with my dad getting older and stuff. I just choose not to
then go, definitely don't watch that video.
Yeah, I choose not to go down that road right now at this point. In Love With The Pain, never heard this one before. Fantastic. Blind Man, fucking fantastic. Blame It on the Boom Boom, this one I know, love it. White Trash Millionaire, you could call me that. and I'm a millionaire because of my friends and family. That's not monetarily.
Ooh.
What?
So cheesy, but that's...
It is, but it's true though. It is. No, I don't care. I am. I consider myself a rich person because of my friends and my family. But it's fucking cool. Yeah, thanks, Dylan. Merry Christmas, motherfucker. Lonely Train. This one I didn't know either. This one rocks too. Pieces Free. Odd choice for an ending song. It kicks up at the end, but I'm like, I would not end the show. Like, I would end the show with Blame It on the Boom Boom or White Trash Millionaire. That's how I would end the show. But this is killer. From the production to the song choice to them playing Royal Albert Hall. Like, there's a great live album that Bonamassa played there. And these guys, if they played the fucking Kirby Center, there'd be fucking 400 people there.
Yeah.
Piss me off.
Bastard faces.
Fucking check these guys out.
All right, Blackstone BC, what do you think?
All right, BB, you know I've been on the Blackstone Cherry boat since 2006 when they first came out. Totally love these guys. I mean, to me, they're so underrated. Like Steve said, United States, they can't barely fill a club, but they're playing stadiums everywhere else and these iconic
criminal
venues. Yep. But, I mean, I love this band.
Do it.
So
do it.
Black Sabbath. All right. So I'm going to name the songs I don't like on this album.
Okay. Drum solo.
Drum solo. I mean, in Love with the Pain. I mean, this is a good set list. I agree with Steve. Maybe if they went out on a real big note with the Blame It on the Boom Boom or White Trash Millionaire.
And that's true to the set list. That is the actual set list they did. It's not mashed around like some bands do.
Cheaper to Drink.
Yeah, killer show to see.
No. I mean, you can relate to all their music. I mean, just... I throw the shit on it. Love it.
Right. Nice. So,
I would take these guys as like a working man's band over fucking Springsteen's bullshit any fucking day.
Oh, fuck yeah.
Any day.
I follow them on, you know, social medias and their YouTube shit. They're just...
Guys hanging out,
guys playing shit. Playing Southern guys, playing rock and roll. Enjoy.
Drinking beer.
I hope they're not Raider fans.
Whoa. Yeah. All right, Dale, what do you think?
Yeah, Blackberry Smoke, really enjoy it. Sorry, Black Country Communion, I really enjoy it.
Black Label Society. Ooh,
Black Label Society.
Yes,
Black Country Communion.
Blackstone Cherry. My problems with the album. Drum solo, of course.
Of course.
Too much talking. The only thing that I really vibed with was during the things my father said.
Right.
I'm absolutely fine with that. Very emotional. It paid off. Like during Pieces Free, I'm like, oh, come on. Like I already don't like the song to begin with, and you're extending it out by being, every time you hear Pieces Free, you'll remember that you were in here. And it's like, yeah. Like they'll remember every other song that they saw live. It's not that difficult. But otherwise, it's a very good album. Too much crowd participation at times where I like to hear the band perform. I don't like to hear...
And you can definitely tell they didn't mic the audience.
No, the audience was so low down.
Very low,
But
yeah, I didn't notice that.
But those are really my only problems with it. I think the guitar sounds fantastic. The drums sound great. Lead singer sounds really good. You could tell that he's not like overdubbed. There's the minor imperfections that make a live album good. Like
worse than all.
Yeah, I don't like when a live album is so polished that, you know, you can't see, because there are times where it almost seems like they might be a little off time, like here and there. But like that's what makes a live album good. It's because like you have that experience of seeing them live. So right. I really did appreciate that. But yeah, the only problems I really had with it were drum solo, talking too much, crowd was turned down a little too low.
Right.
Yeah. Otherwise, fantastic live album.
What do you guys? I think that, and I know
also Pieces Free should not be closer.
Headliner bands do drum solos. I get it; it gives the rest of the band a break. But like the drummer hardly ever gets a break unless do an acoustic thing,
which they do after that.
Right?
Because things my father says right after.
They it could be cool watching it because it could be a really cool dynamic solo. But like they don't translate well on albums.
No.
You know, they really don't. Like, the only one that, you know, there's two. And it's the one, 100,000 Years on Kiss Alive and God of Thunder on Kiss Alive 2. They're the only two that I will actually listen to without going, okay, I heard it once, good. And even Neil Peart, for as much as I love him, I'm like, I can't listen to a drum solo on an album. I just, you know, and no offense to any drummers out there, I love you guys. You're the, you know, you're the heartbeat of the bands, but like, And like I said, I get why they're there, but I'm just like, I don't want to hear it on an album. I know they exist. I know they're there. And actually, I just started listening to Rob Halford's book, Biblical, on audiobook. And he starts talking about Scott Travis and about drum solos. Like, he'll go over, okay, talk about singers, right? He says, like, Robert Plant and Freddie Mercury and stuff like that. And how, you know, you ever see the people watching the videos of, like, Rob Halford singing, like, Painkiller, and like, oh my God, like, you know what I mean, shit like that. He talks about that, but then he talks about guitar players, and he talks about bass players, but then he talks about drummers. And he said, like, Scott Travis, like, when they're talking about set lists and stuff like that, he really does not want to do a drum solo. He's like, really, do I have to do a drum solo? He doesn't want to fucking do them.
Mm-hmm.
But he understands that it gives the band, the rest of the band, a break. But, like, Scott but, Travis like, is not even one of the fucking drum solo.
Well, like when we saw them live, Scott like took the time to talk to the
right.
audience.
Right. Like I think he would rather just say hello to the crowd than fucking do a drum solo.
So
right.
like the yeah.
So I mean, I get that. I mean, I get why they exist and stuff like that. But on a live album, like I don't want to hear it. I just don't want to hear it. I don't want to hear a guitar solo on. I don't know. I would rather hear a band tear up a song and make it a 10-minute song with back and forth dual solos or a guy doing some crazy shit with the band playing along than just some guy playing
one
solo.
Instrument. Yeah.
Like how the,
you
know the what conspirators
extend out of the city. Yeah. God love Eddie Van Halen, like arguably the best guitar player that ever lived. I don't want to hear his solo on an album. I don't want to hear it. I saw it live. Okay, I'm good. You know?
When you're a band at this level, why put a solo on there when you have such a catalog?
Yeah, right.
Put an Ursan on there. I mean, like
right.
you said,
yeah. I just wanted to go into a little rant there. So sorry to hijack.
You can do like a bluesy like band jam.
Yeah. I love that. I love when bands like extend this. Like, can they give the song some time to breathe? They do some crazy shit. Like Priest when they do Sinner, that was KK Downing's song where he'd do the crazy soloing and the whammy bar shit. That shit I love, but I don't want to hear a jump solo. Although, right. BB, I know you want Ian Hill to have a bass solo.
Yes!
Like Michael Anthony. Like, God love him. I don't want to hear him jumping on his bass on a fucking album.
Right. Exactly.
I can get that experience at home.
Exactly.
All right, in true PTH fashion here, why don't we just go around the table, we'll say our happy holidays, our goodbyes, and... let's rank these albums. So, Dylan, let's rank them for you. What do you got?
First off, happy birthday. Great choices. Albums I never would have listened to outside of this. I mean, besides Steel Panther. Because I'm not as versed in Blackstone Cherry as the rest of you are. They're not a go-to band for me. But if I had to rank them, I think I would go Steel Panther number one. And this is probably going to be the only time you ever hear me say that.
Wow.
Because the music...
The big one, Alice.
The music levels that they're on that album are phenomenal. Satchel's guitar work is so underrated, and he deserves more recognition than he gets. I'm going to go Blackstone Cherry number two. I loved how the live energy of that album is, and I have my problems with it, but it's still a really, really great showcase of the band. My number three is going to be Level 10. Because, again, it's a fantastic album, a really good heavy metal album. There's just some dissonance at times with the vocals, and the one ballad I was not as big a fan of, that power ballad. And then Coney Hatch I'll put number four, but it's not, you know, I hate this album number four. It's
from 1982.
It's an also ran. Yeah, it's an also ran. Where, like, I was vibing more with the other albums before over that one. But it's still a fantastic pick, and I really do think you had some really good albums that you brought to the table today. You can listen to a selection of them on our Spotify playlist of the week underneath the show notes. And happy holidays to everybody, whatever you celebrate, whoever you celebrate with. Hope you stay safe and, you know, drink a couple if you're not sober for on us. We will not be paying it, though.
BC, what do you got?
Happy birthday and welcome to the top of the hill.
Because now it's...
Oh, he's just downhill from there.
The Grants.
Yeah, big hells and shit. Oh, another fun episode. If I have to list them, I'm going to go with Blackstone Cherry just because I just totally dig this band. I'm going to go with number two, Level 10. Never heard of these guys before. Put it on. I was like, yes. Something, something different and new. Well, not new, but new to me. Steel Panther after that. And then I'm going to finish it up with Coney Edge.
Nice. Alrighty, Roddy. Bring it home, buddy.
All right, BB, happy birthday. I love you, buddy. My other brother from another mother. Be 50. Wow, that's insane. BB's birthday is actually on the 22nd, which will be the day before this comes out. Yep. Day before this comes out. So you will be 50 when this comes out.
I will be in my 50s.
You'll be in your 50s. Welcome to the 50 Club.
Woohoo!
And, I love the birthday episodes. Love them. I've said it every single time. I got to say it again. This is the only one that I really insist that we're all here for the birthday episodes. We're recording much later tonight than we have in a while, which is fine because we recorded early too. Just harkening back to the early days, BC, we'd be fucking leaving at fucking midnight and shit. We're not quite to that point yet, but I love the birthday episodes. It's fun, and I would say probably me and BC are more predictable birthday album-wise that we pick.
We're the wild cards.
And BB and Dylan are the ones that pick, because when BB picked these, I'm like...
What the fuck like, is level this?
Level
10,
I'm like, okay. And then, like, I was like, Blackstone Cherry, that's a long one. I'm like, fuck. like, Coney Hatch, like, okay, I know that's a short one. I know that one. That was good. But, and I don't think I've ever hated... Well, no, I can't say that. There's very few birthday albums that I've hated.
That's not true.
Few that I've hated from the birthday episodes. One band that starts with a W ends with an Weezer. Weezer's one of them. But this was fun, though. And my rankings are going to be level 10 because just I love the Russell Allen-ness of this one, and the guitar playing is phenomenal on it. Production is great. And I like the early frontiers-ness of this album. Number 2 is going to be Blackstone Cherry because there was so much more on that album than I didn't know.
Right.
Like I said, I knew if you want to call them hits or the well-known songs from them, I knew them. But there was a lot of songs on there that I'm like, oh, shit, I didn't know this one was fucking killer. Their drummer's absolutely killer on there. I'm going to go Steel Panther next for if they did that as a 10-song album, chopped off 2 songs on there, ended with If I Were the King, If I Was King, I think it is right. That would have been probably number 1, just because there was a couple kind of meh songs on there for me. That's like there. And Coney Hatch, and nothing against Coney Hatch, Something's got to be in the 4 spot. But there's no skippers on that album for me.
No.
And the only reason that's below Steel Panther is because the songs that I like on Steel Panther, I like a lot more than the ones I like on Coney Hatch. But I want to say Merry Christmas to everybody out there. Happy Hanukkah. Kwanzaa, whatever the hell you guys celebrate out there. Enjoy.
Festivus.
Coming out Festivus. Actually, this will be out on Festivus. Happy Festivus. Get the pole out of the crawl space. do the feats of strength.
No tinsel, though.
No tinsel. It's very distracting. And, celebrate your right to celebrate weird holidays.
Yeah,
right?
I can't remember that. Celebrate fictitious holidays.
So, guys, when you celebrate safely. Have a driver. Just be careful. We have a ugly sweater party coming up at BC's, and I will have the best fucking ugly sweater, by the way. It is going to be the ugly, coolest sweater at the party. So just Merry Christmas out there, guys. Happy New Year. We'll talk to you again before New Year's, though. But BB, once again, happy birthday. Welcome to the 50 Club.
Woo-hoo.
I love you, buddy. I give it cheers at the end here. All right. Give a little tap there. Bang, 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 bang. A little sip. I'll let BB take us out here.
All righty.
Hopefully take us out here.
We'll see what happens here. We'll see if I trip over my own feet this time. But no, honestly... Thank you guys out there. Thank you for, spending time with us out there. I know it's the holiday season and spending time listening to my birthday albums. Thank you guys at the table. This is awesome. I wouldn't want to be any other place than right here, right now, partying, drinking, recording with you guys. This is great. Smoking and drinking. And fighting, pissing. And this is great. Just like Steve said, that the birthday episodes are awesome. We always try to bring something different, and I always try to find these obscure things to bring that kind of sound something that we would like to listen to. And I'm glad you guys enjoyed a couple of these albums tonight. And it's funny. I don't want to touch my pen. I just want you to see I have exactly what Steve wrote down, and I can't believe it because it's probably the first time in ever that we actually agree on the order of albums. So
wow. I can see that.
Yeah. Level 10, Blackstone Cherry, Steel Panther, and Coney Hatch. I think it's just like everybody kind of said, the Coney Hatch has that, it has that 80, if it was 82, maybe it'd be a different story, but it has that 82 feel to it. Nothing take away from them because there's a lot of good stuff on there. And the Steel Panther, musically great, but just the live version of the Blackstone Cherry, just how they make you feel that you're there and how they tear it up. And in level 10, like I said, that one song, it's Cry No More. I absolutely love that song. But so guys out there, celebrate, you know, happy holidays, whatever you celebrate. Take care of yourself and each other. And we'll see you next time, and there definitely will be a next time. And that's like a fucking do it, Poonie.